He's been in Australia a few times now. Tim comes from Salt Lake City in Utah, and this time he's come to us via the land of the Great White Cloud. If you're not quite sick of New Zealanders yet, there's still one Kiwi over here somewhere. Gareth, yeah, so Gareth is there. Tim, and I've got a lot to be grateful for at VeraSage Institute. People like Paul O'Byrne, the late Paul O'Byrne, Ron himself, fellows who are in this room, including Tim, literally have changed my life both professionally and personally, and certainly Tim's one of those in particular. He's a senior fellow, he's the founder of the Ignition Consulting Group, author of several books, including Positioning for Professionals. If you haven't read it, if you haven't got it, please do so. It's a fantastic book. He's an international speaker, he's a thought leader, especially in the advertising and marketing industries. He's the 21st century's Don Draper. So, over to you, Tim.
The same phenomenon applies to professional service firms and our tendency to keep adding and adding more and more features, more and more services until we become a lot less valuable to our clients and prospects. You can think of it, we'll have a session later on design thinking, but you can think of it as in this way from the book from the thinker John Polko. He said, leading companies say no much more than they say yes. Rather than chase the market with follow-on features, they leave the market with a constrained focus. So it's not in our nature to say no, is it? And it's not in our nature to subtract. We're always in the mode of adding. When you think about, you
go to a strategic offsite planning session and you've got the whiteboards up on the wall and you're asking for everyone's contributions, you're having a brainstorm session, you go back to the office with a big, long list of, well, we should do this, we should do this, we should do this, right? We should be doing the opposite thing. We should spend our strategic planning sessions deciding what to subtract, what to eliminate, how to simplify the focus of our firms. We have, I don't know how many of these I've got in my home, and it takes an apple to come along and do this, right? It's easy to be complicated and to be complex. That's easy. To simplify, to make the user experience and the customer experience simple is difficult. Apple has done it many times, and interestingly, they were the early Jonathan Ives and the early designers at Apple were inspired by Pablo Picasso, who in his early career drew a bowl that looked like the one on the far left, and then it became more abstract and more abstract, but finally, I mean, on the far right you can still tell that's a bowl, but it's pretty simple. He simplified his concepts and his illustration as time went on. Apple did the exact same thing with the mouse. It got simpler and simpler, features removed as time went on, same with their design of all of their products. So this is the work that we need to be doing in our own firms. Steve Jobs famously had this philosophy of less, not more. And many of you know the story of Jobs, who was kicked out of his own company and then brought back to rescue it. And at the time, one of the first things Jobs did is he got his team together and he said, guys, we have a product line. Apple was not doing well at the time. We have a product line of over 350 products under development currently. He got up on the whiteboard and he scratched out every single one of those 350 products except four. He said, we're going to do four things. We're going to focus on four products. And he set his team on the course of doing few things really, really well. Even today, Apple has only, well, less than 100 SKUs, you know that term, as compared to a Hewlett-Packard that has 15,000. If we compare the market cap of Apple with the market cap of HP, we know which is the better company. In fact, speaking of market cap, you look at PepsiCo, pretty successful company. They make lots of different food products, things you can consume. Pepsi does pretty well. Their market cap, $133 billion. It's a good-sized company. And for a long time, the Coca-Cola company, their chief rival, was doing the exact same thing. They were diversifying. They were adding more and more snack foods and other kinds of consumables to their product line. But at one point, they realized they were headed in the wrong direction, had a very important strategic planning session, and emerged from that and decided that they were just going to focus on things you can drink, just beverages. We're going to eliminate everything else from our product line. As a result, Coca-Cola, and this keeps changing. In fact, I updated this morning, the current market cap of Coca-Cola, $223 billion. These companies used to be neck and neck. So this is the power of simplifying, reducing, streamlining your product line. And it applies to companies like ours, just as well as consumer products companies. I love this quote from Miles Davis. It's not the notes you play that matter, it's the notes you don't play. It's the notes you leave out, it's the rests that are on the score, not just the notes themselves. This is what differentiates us in the eyes of our customers and prospects. This is, in behavioral economic terms, called the paradox of choice. It's a strange phenomenon, and it's quite counterintuitive, because we assume the more choice we provide, the more opportunities we give customers to engage with us, the more doors we leave open, the more product they'll buy, and the truth is the exact opposite is the case.
in the UK, there are famous studies showing that, of course, the Brits love their jam. And if you go into a typical UK grocery store, there are lots and lots of choices of jam. In one famous experiment, they eliminated the choices down to just three, and sales went up. You offer fewer options. Actually, you can make the choice much easier for customers, because when we present too much choice, it creates this phenomenon called the paradox of choice. And let me give you another illustration from the world of fast food. This is McDonald's. The average, this keeps changing, but the average menu board on a McDonald's would be at least 57, 60 menu items. If you've ever visited an In-N-Out Burger in the U.S. that has a cult-like following, you look at their menu, it's basically three things. It's burgers, fries, and drinks. In-N-Out Burger earns three times the profit McDonald's does. In other words, they do very few things, but they do it really, really well. And if you ever have the opportunity to visit an In-N-Out Burger, I think you'll see why. So let me introduce a quick clip. This is Barry Schwartz, who is going to talk to us about this phenomenon of the paradox of choice.
With so many options to choose from, people find it very difficult to choose at all. I'll give you one very dramatic example of this, a study that was done of investments in voluntary retirement plans. A colleague of mine got access to investment records from Vanguard, the gigantic mutual fund company of about 1 million employees in about 2,000 different workplaces. And what she found is that for every 10 mutual funds the employer offered, rate of participation went down 2%. You offer 50 funds, 10% fewer employees participate than if you only offer five. Why? Because with 50 funds to choose from, it's so damn hard to decide which funds to choose that you'll just put it off till tomorrow, and then tomorrow, and then tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow, and of course tomorrow never comes. Understand that not only does this mean that people are going to have to eat dog food when they retire because they don't have enough money put away, it also means that making the decision is so hard that they pass up significant matching money from the employer. By not participating, they are passing up as much as $5,000 a year from the employer, who would happily match their contribution. So paralysis is a consequence of having too many choices.
Too much choice. And we do this. When you visit the website of the average professional service firm and you look at that page that says services, and practices, and industries, and sectors, in some cases, it's a very, very long list. So the question is, how can we apply the same kind of thinking that Apple stores employ in their store design versus you walk into, I don't know if you have a Best Buy or its equivalent in Australia, very overwhelming, don't know exactly where to start. And of course, Apple outsells Best Buy per square foot by a long shot. The highest per square foot sales of any retailer, with a very sparse layout and many fewer choices. This idea of let's just keep introducing more and more varieties of the same thing. I don't know if you could read these, but these are all the different varieties of Colgate toothpaste. There's whitening and Max Fresh and Clinical and liquid and powder and foam and spearmint and sensitive tooth and advanced whitening. You know what's been happening to their market share? Can you guess? So your firm is very likely in this same situation, over-design, over-diversity. So I'd like to walk through a series of ways to think about this that hopefully can help you decide which of these directions you want to go. It's human nature to want to expand and enlarge and broaden and widen and add and diversify and augment, because we confuse that with growth. We think that's the way to grow, versus deciding what were the few things that we can do consistently well.
the idea of being narrow is scary, but narrow does not mean small. Some of the largest companies on the planet are actually quite narrow in terms of their product offerings. Michael Porter, this is my all-time favorite definition of strategy. The essence of strategy is choosing what not to do. It's easy to decide what to do. The big long bullet point list of we could do this and this, and we could be in this sector, we could develop this practice area, that's easy. Deciding what not to do is the essence of making strategic choices. So strategy is the services you don't offer, the clients you don't have, the practices you don't have, the markets you don't serve. That's strategy. Strategy is about making actual decisions that impact what you offer or don't offer, with emphasis on the don't. We sometimes, especially in our business, we confuse our reputation, our fame, with a business strategy. Because we're well known, because we have good name recognition, we assume that's what differentiates us. Well, it's useful to have fame and to be well known in the market. That's a good thing. But reputational capital by itself is not a business strategy, and it does not equal differentiation. It's one aspect of differentiation. We've got to make much more structural, foundational choices when it comes to business strategy. Let me show you an example of how this plays out in other sectors. This is an example from Germany.
On the outskirts of the sleepy town of Gütersloh in northwest Germany is Miele, a company that's been making kitchen and laundry appliances in the area for over 100 years. Across the country, over 10,000 of its employees produce over 1 million washing machines and tumble dryers every year. With annual sales of 2.8 billion euros, the company now has 8 plants across Germany. Miele is one of many small and medium-sized German businesses known collectively as the Mittelstand. Firms like these provide the muscle to the country's economic might. Other nations may quake in the face of competition from Asia, but not Germany. Its luxury manufacturers sell posh cars to the new Asian rich, and the Mittelstand makes machine tools and equipment that Chinese firms use to make consumer goods. But what makes the Mittelstand so successful? In recent years, politicians have done a lot to help. In reforming the country's labor market, successive governments have been ahead of the curve. But so have Mittelstand companies themselves, constantly innovating, adapting, and evolving. By avoiding debt, specializing in niche markets, developing product-related services, and investing in vocational training, Germany's small and medium-sized companies have remained at the cutting edge of global manufacturing. The Mittelstand's success has attracted admiring glances from the rest of Europe, but it's built on foundations that may be hard to copy, from Germany's family traditions to its skilled workers. Like Silicon Valley, the Mittelstand remains one of a kind.
That's the power of focus in action. It works in manufacturing, it works in technology, it works in professional services. So what happens is when we have the mental discipline to focus on a few competencies that we do really, really well, it actually delivers to our clients and prospects the three things that they really desire when they hire us. They certainly hire us to solve problems. They want a quality solution, and so by focusing and doing fewer things better, we actually are more effective. We have deeper expertise. We're able to solve problems more effectively. It actually helps us with speed. Sometimes we think that expertise and speed go in sometimes in the opposite direction, but having deep expertise means we can actually deliver solutions faster, and we get it right the first time. you can hire, your clients can hire lesser skilled firms, they can hire cheaper people, they can try to find solutions for those with lower hourly rates, dare I say. None of you here are billing by the hour. But in the end, that's going to cost them in all three of these areas, isn't it? Quality, speed, and cost effectiveness. I like this framework in terms of how to test your strategy. So this is Roger Martin, teaches strategy up in Toronto. And he says the first question to ask of any strategy is this: would it be rational to choose the opposite of your strategy? Or could a business make the opposite choice without looking stupid? So we look at what we promise, and let's ask the question, what would it look like to articulate this strategy in opposite terms? So let's take an example. This is a top 100 law firm. We commit our energies and talents to being our clients' most valued and trusted advisors. We demonstrate continuous, unremitting, effective effort and an unwavering adherence to the highest professional standards and service for our clients. Pretty vague to begin with, but it's got all the buzzwords, doesn't it? The continuous, unremitting, effective, unwavering, highest professional standards. So we think that covers this, right? We've checked all the boxes. But now let's apply Martin's opposite test. What happens if we state this in opposite terms? Well, we commit our energies and talents to being our clients' least valued and trusted advisors. We demonstrate very little effort and adhere only to minimum professional standards in the service of our clients. Makes no sense, does it? It doesn't pass the test. It actually is, that would be stupid. We would be looking stupid. And if we look at the so-called positioning strategies of most firms working with you to achieve your commercial goals, what's the opposite of that? Does it make any sense? No. Our hand-picked legal talent cut through complexity to deliver decisive direction for your business. You know, on the face of it, an important promise, but you certainly can't apply the opposite test and have it be effective. So what's an example of a strategy where you could state it in opposite terms and it would still make sense? A natural technology and life sciences law firm. Okay, you could state the opposite of that and it would still be valid, but it's specific enough that it's not this statement of vacuous promises that again, if you turn them around, make no sense. And we sometimes get into this kind of a process, fill the blank, guideline, and relentless focus on quality, no matter what you that. Another cliche, another, we will start to long-winded phrase, delivering to our, right? And then quality, we've already used that. Quality, leadership, effectiveness, those are the shop-worn words in our business that have completely lost their meaning. They mean nothing. They mean nothing. So to develop an effective strategy means making choices. And it also means realizing what a strategy is not. And a lot of what I'm about to put up on this list, these are things that masquerade for a strategy. And we think because we have this, we have a strategy. Strategy is not a tagline or slogan. It's not a unique name or logo. It's not your commitment to excellence. It's not your long and distinguished history. It's not your deep commitment to client relationships, your track record, your recognition, your awards, your reputation as a great place to work, your exceptional lineup of talent, your ability to solve complex problems, or your reputation for outstanding client service. These things are important. These are desirable characteristics of a quality professional firm, but none of them distinguish you from other firms. And one of the easy tests here is the "your name goes here" test. You can take most firms' websites and their promotional literature and just substitute some other firm's logo, and it would be, yeah, okay, I guess that's right. Pretty interchangeable in terms of what we say about ourselves. So how do we dig down and make these deliberate choices that I'm talking about at a more foundational level? Well, the place to start is actually to stand back, step back, and look for patterns. Look for threads, common threads in what you do. Because I've had the experience many times working in professional firms where we're halfway through a day-long session and we've got on the wall all sorts of competencies and sector expertise, big, big, long list. But we're on a mission to try and select the ones that are most meaningful and most differentiated. It's really, really difficult because there's so much. If you look at the institutional history of the firm, especially one that's been around how many years, Andrew? 170? Wow. Yeah, so that's a pretty long list dating all the way back then. It's a little bit like this from a movie you might have seen.
Glad you could come, Doctor.
We've been intercepting radio transmissions from Moscow.
The computer can't detect a pattern, but I'm sure it's code.
Why is that, John?
Ever just know something, Dr. Mash?
Constantly.
We've developed several ciphers. If you'd like to review our preliminary data,
choose a very deep
then you can have a broader set of services. So if you are a, if your specialty is serving media companies, that's a fairly narrow focus too, you can offer lots of different services for that industry. But the key here is you have to choose. Generally, you have to either be a what specialist or a who specialist, because if you try to be, you try to have a little bit of everything in both those areas, what is that? Well, that's a non-positioning. That's then you're the country lawyer, you're the country doctor, you're the firm in town that attracts a little bit of everything from the kinds of clients that I think most of us really don't want. To attract the kinds of clients we do want, we have to have some form of exclusivity in one of those two areas. My friend David Baker has what he calls the stopwatch test, which is this. Start the stopwatch, and then calculate the amount of time it takes a client to find a firm that can replace you. In other words, how quickly can one of your clients or prospects identify another firm that looks just like you? Yeah, well, we can hire these guys, or these guys, or these guys. They all appear to do the same thing. You want to do, I mean, the ultimate positioning strategy is to be in a category of one. That's the ultimate. So that's pretty difficult. That does exist in some categories. It doesn't last forever. But most of us have the opposite problem. My other friend in the consulting world in marketing communications, Blair Inns, I love this idea. The client source of power is the oversupply of similar firms. That's what gives clients power. That's what gives procurement people, if they ever have to deal with them, the leverage in negotiations is because in their minds there are other firms very similar, so we don't get to see you. Else versus, no, actually, we're one of the very few firms that do what you're looking for. You see the difference in terms of the leverage you would have. So the intersection and interplay of what and who, very important. Now, you can think creatively about this as well. It doesn't mean that you can't have a little variety in what you offer. It just has to be connected. Has to be interconnected. And I was fascinated to see this example of how Walt Disney actually did diversify his company, but in a very connected, integrated way. He started with the creative talent of the studio, meaning the theatrical films, the early Disney films, you know, Snow White, his first animated feature, and then building on that, the other animated features that came along. He found ways to leverage the centerpiece, his what, into other related areas that all correlate back to this, the Disney magic. And this is what is called the development of an ecosystem. You've got an ecosystem of competencies that are all mutually supported. And an ecosystem of aligned expertise, core competencies work synergistically to create not just vertical or horizontal specialization, but functional integration. So the what, who are a little bit of the horizontal and the vertical. This is another way to think about it, in which you take a company like Apple, who has the Mac and the iPhone and the iPad and the watch and iTunes and now HomeKit and now Apple TV. And as you well know, you Apple users, if you buy any one of these things, you are now in Apple's ecosystem. Their ecosystem of products and services that all work beautifully, one with another. They're integrated, they build one upon the other. And this can be done also in professional services. Another notable example is Nike. They make shoes, they make shoes, of course, which is where they started, but expanded into apparel and equipment. But now there's the Nike Fuel Band, that you can track your runs and your running, that talks to your shoes and it helps you improve and get better. This is a good example of an ecosystem in which one product and competency builds upon the other. So I'd like to recommend that instead of diversifying into new sectors and new practice areas, grow your business by mining the potential that you already have in the current areas of expertise you already have. Develop offerings that meet the underserved needs of your current and prospective clients. You've already got some sector expertise. What are the unserved, unmet needs of those clients in that sector? Develop new bundles of services and solution sets as programs. So I referenced this during the panel discussion a little bit yesterday. A lot of what we have as bullet point lists of services can be put together, bundled together in interesting, compelling ways, and turned into programs, named programs. Bundle your offerings in a way that's never been done before, unique combinations of services that competitors would find difficult to copy. So it's not the services themselves, it's the way you bundle them together. And Apple's a pretty good example. I mean, any one of those, their products on its own, it's good, but may not be completely unique, but once you look at it in context of their entire ecosystem, it's very unique. Create simpler, less expensive versions of over-designed offerings that appeal to less demanding customer segments. This is a fancy way of saying, find a way to simplify your logic, the logic services, the logic work that you do, and make that kind of work easy to buy, easy to sell, easy to buy for your clients and prospects. So when we do this, we benefit from what is sometimes called a coherence premium. Coherent companies earn twice the profit of those that are diversified. This has been widely studied. This is called the diversification discount, where you can Google this and you'll see that the diversified companies are not as highly valued by professional investors. They will actually discount that. A company that's widely diversified, their stock will be discounted somewhere between 10% and 12%, because investors know that that company, because it's so diversified, is not going to be as profitable as other companies that have consolidated their product lines, as in the Coke and Pepsi example that we looked at quickly yesterday. Coke benefits from the simplification of their product lines. These authors' strategy that works go on to say, when your company is coherent, you don't have to struggle to overcome the strategy to execution gap. There is no gap. All your products and services are supported by the same group of distinctive capabilities serving the same value proposition. So, what's the litmus test for having a good strategy? How would you know if your strategy, if you pushed your strategy far enough? Let me suggest seven tests. Does it allow for clear identification of target prospects? Does it help us say no to the wrong prospects? Are we clear about who's a prospect and who's not a prospect based on our what and our who? Does it help us expand our geographical footprint? So this is a counterintuitive piece of about strategy. The more narrow our offering, the more likely we are to appeal to clients and prospects beyond our borders. None of us would travel outside of our neighborhood for a general practitioner doctor, for a family doctor. But we would fly across the country to go to a neurosurgeon, wouldn't we? See how that works? The more focused you are, the more likely a prospect would travel 1,000 miles to do business with you. If you're just doing family medicine, not the same thing. Does it create strong barriers to entry, meaning would it be difficult for other firms to copy what you do? Does it result in fewer competitors? Because if you're doing something scarce and unique, obviously you're not going to have nearly as many firms claiming the same. Does it allow us to charge higher fees? This is the ultimate benefit. Again, what's scarce is valuable. And finally, does it make our business development cycle shorter and less expensive? As in, are we able to get more business through referral and without having to compete for it, pitch for it, because we're so well aligned with what a prospect needs that we don't have to go through that. So just in closing, I'm going to show you one of my favorite examples of being focused. If you've studied your Greek history, you know about the Spartans and how they were trained as children, as warriors, and that's really what they just were groomed for battle, and that distinguished them from a lot of other civilizations at the time. And they were pretty fierce to compete against. So maybe some of you have seen this movie 300 Spartans, but I love this clip that distills much what we're talking about.
Daxos,
what a pleasant surprise!
This morning's full of surprises.
This is a surprise.
Silence! We heard Sparta was on the warpath. We were eager to join forces.
If it is blood you seek,
you are welcome to join us. But you bring only this handful of soldiers against Xerxes. You see, I was wrong to expect Sparta's commitment to at least match our own.
Doesn't it?
You,
there. Is your profession?
I'm a potter. And you, Arcadian, what is your profession?
Sculptor, sir.
You?
Blacksmith.
Spartans! What is your profession?
So if you're positioned correctly, you can win the battle before you fight. And the moral here, complexities for amateurs, the more you study about business strategy, the more you realize that subtracting is the essence of a successful business strategy. So thanks for letting me present twice. I'm going to set a couple of books out on the front counter if you want to take a look at them. You can track me down here in the usual ways, and we can do the Q&A thing on the LinkedIn as well.
Yeah,
if
there
is
any questions, yeah. If you're morning tea.
Okay. I didn't know if you wanted to spend the time.
Yes. No?
Yes. Yeah, the box should work, John, if you want to use that.
Oh, the box?
It should work. Right, Paul?
Yeah.
You can trust me to throw this? Okay.
You trust me to catch it?
Because I'm going to knock over somebody's poppy.
Before I met the computers.
Talking to the black bit at the top, talking to the top.
There you go, that's a new experience. Thank you very much, Tim, that was wonderful. How does that sit with what we've been talking about yesterday around the subscription model? And, you know, how you align those two sort of things, because I could see them going potentially different ways.
Interesting question. Well, in my view, and I've actually debriefed a little bit with Ed about this, my view is that in terms of pricing strategy, the subscription model should be something that you do. It could be a lot of what you do, but it's likely not going to be exclusively what you do. There are lots of other elements of what I call a pricing stack, of which subscriptions is one, but fixed price for fixed service is one, and there are lots of other things you could be doing. So I don't see them as mutually exclusive. I see the subscription model, a good place to start with the subscription model is through productization and subscriptions to programs versus subscribing to your firm. Seems an easier place to start for me. And I think those products and services could be very supportive of your position strategy. I don't see this going in opposite directions.
Yeah.
I land on the kite. So,
couldn't you just say that your subscription model could be targeted very narrowly, like your quadrants, to only certain markets, and within that market, we have a broad subscription. Broad scope for your subscription model, right?
Sure, or it could represent some of your bread and butter services that you think that you can do over and over. I referenced some PR firms yesterday that have turned into subscription social media community management programs and crisis mitigations programs. Those are bread and butter competencies for PR firms, but they're now sold via subscription.
Any other questions?
Uh-oh. See, one whole experiment that we're still trying to work out, it's really almost a question, is when you look back at the long tail, if you set technology right with the subscription, that in fact is your highest margin in your business?
In the long tail?
Potentially.
Yeah, interesting. Which is what you've been doing.
We're trying to do. Yeah. But it's a real.
But you're selling things. You've got a margin because you apply your technology to leverage.
Sure.
Correct. So arguably, that's maybe not doesn't qualify for long tail. Yeah.
Thanks. That's incredibly challenging. Lots of things. I'm
closer.
I'm not being presumptuous here, but I suspect that many of the firms in this room, certainly the one that came from the role of, are generalists.
Sure.
And that presents a real challenge about how you market yourself as a generalist.
Yeah.
Have a point of differentiation. And one of the things that, when I spoke briefly yesterday, is choosing clients to work with rather than sectors to work. Can that be a point of differentiation and something you can use strategically?
As in types of clients?
Well, yeah, but one of the things that came out yesterday in the design work as well is the fact that people want to build more humanistic kind of organisations. So if you say, look, they're the kind of clients we want to work with as well. We don't want to work with clients who are prepared to do anything to maximise their revenue.
Sure. Yeah, that would be, I mean that's a slippery slope in the sense that I think it's sometimes hard to draw the line. But that's a version of a defining your who, is to say we want to work with these kinds of clients who exhibit this kind of behavior or are trying to do this type of thing. There's an agency in the U.S. that, and this is completely controversial, but I admire it. They say they only want to work with brands that are made in America, manufactured in America. That's pretty interesting. So that's not a sector, but it's putting a stake in the ground in a very unique kind of a who. So long way of saying, yeah, that if you're careful about defining that so that not everybody would qualify, because I hear sometimes, well, we only want to work with clients want to do good in the world. And that can be a pretty long list. So it needs to be a little more narrow than that. But yes, that's a
good one. Can I jump in on this process? Let me see if we get this working now too. We're doing pretty good with the microphones today, aren't we?
Yeah, you're doing good. Don't say that. I see a real flying by.
Yeah, it's not working. Yes. And this is something I teach in my consulting class, which is a thing from Peter Block. And he's got this idea that there's three types of expert or consultants that you can have. You can have an expert, a pair of hands, and then collaborative partner, collaborator. This is the three different types of overall general consulting work, of which all professional services falls in under the giant umbrella of consulting. Does that make sense? And the question that he proposes that you ask a customer to draw a triangle like this or have this ready and say, put a dot in this triangle near the place where the type of relationship that you are most looking for. So if you're really looking for just a pair of hands to somebody help you through some process and outsource extra work, draw the dot closer to a pair of hands. If you're looking for an expert here, collaborative partner, draw the dot here. It's a non-threatening question, because you're just trying to define the relationship. I've been working with a firm that does exclusively CRM,
software. That's all they do, is the installation of a CRM. And unless the prospective customer puts the dot here or near collaborator, they don't take them on. Because they're, in their opinion, a CRM implementation can only be effective if they're looking for a collaborator. If they say, yeah, we're really looking for just some kind of an expert to come in and do this for us, it's not going to be successful. And I don't think there's not a moral power of any one of these. None of these are better than the other. But Tim, would you agree? It's a strategic decision
for
as
sure.
to what type of customer do you want to take on.
Yeah, it's also a dimension of massive.
And right, and does that get to your question about like the type of customer? I mean, I think that this is a different, another way of looking at it. And I found this to be extraordinarily powerful because again, it's non-threatening. This, if you ask this other prospective customer, they're not looking at this going, oh, what's trying to happen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We got several hands. I know we had one back here.
Tim, yeah. I have a question. In the early presentations of Ron Baker that I had attended, many of you may have also had, talking 7 or 8 years ago, Ron had a couple of expressions. One was pricing is marketing and marketing is strategy. Do you subscribe to that principle that pricing is strategy? Or forms part of strategy.
Pricing?
Yes.
Oh, absolutely. They're completely. These are two sides of the same coin. Your positioning strategy and your pricing strategy are absolutely completely related because the I've said it many times. The more narrow you are, the harder it is for clients to find what another firm that does what you do. The more pricing leverage you have, the more valuable you are to your clients. The more the price premium, the more rewarding the work, you know, in my view. And let me just say also to the question of generalists, I kind of learned through the school of hard knocks in my consulting work that some firms actually do want to be generalists and they like it. They don't mind being in a smaller market and having most of their clients within 100 miles, and they like the variety, and they don't like to travel, they like to go home at night to see their families, and they like to be involved in the local community. You know what, that's fine. But if your aspirations are to work outside your market, to be known for something, to attract the bigger, more sophisticated clients with bigger budgets, arguably maybe more interesting work, you can do that as well. They're just two different business strategies.
Well, I think that you actually answered his question in your slides, that you're going to be a generalist, then you're going to focus on the who, not the what, because the what's a lot. I'm pretty much a generalist, so I focus on high net worth. So in my market,
yeah, you're a boot specialist.
Yeah, so in my market, I charge somewhere between 4 and 5 times what, yeah, 6-7 times what other CPAs charge. I know, and I'm settled with the fact that most people are my client. So that, you know, when people come in, I've got a good reputation. I get a lot of people coming in. I turn away half of them. I can just look at their stuff and say, you know, I'm not worth it to you because. I'm not gonna fill my head with those clients. So everyone resides in my head. I've been spending that decades.
Yeah.
I've only got so much space in there. So for you to be in there, you're gonna pay me a lot because I'm only going to know about. I have about 200 clients. And most CPAs in my area work with between 600 and 900 clients. And I make as much money, but I charge literally. My average client pays about $4,500. That's average over everybody. So I'm at $45,000.
So the CPA is a catch one, so we can continue with it.
Yeah, it's not working.
Yeah, it's well.
So anyway, the point is focus on the who. You know, you're gonna be a generalist, it's perfect, but focus on the who. You know, restrict the people, expect them to pay more. And be really great. You know, deliver. If you're gonna do that, you've got to deliver.
Thanks, Justin. Thanks, team. That's actually that gone through as well, Dan. So
yes, that's it.